Welcome to a new test and teardown video. This time it's one of those big screen scopes from Leader. This one is called LBO-9C. I don't know if the deflection is magnetic or static. We're going to figure this out soon. This scope is only rated for 10 kilohertz. So that could be a magnetic deflection system. But other than that, it looks like it's more or less like a normal oscilloscope. But I got a little bit of special features. Let's try and inspect the rear panel before we power this up. So here is the rear. And that will of course be power supply cooling. We've got pulse marker and set gain and horizontal in. Vertical in here is not mounted. Polarity. Yeah, that's more or less what we got. We got also a remote clamp on and off. I'm not sure what that is yet. I can't find a manual online, so please, if you got a manual, upload it somewhere, share it with us. We'll be super happy to get a manual. But now, let's try and power it up and see what happens. So here we go. I am ready with a 1 kilohertz signal. Let me take it down to 1 volt RMS input, so it's not crazy powerful. Let's turn on the mains, and that, ooh, can you hear that? It's 47 watts. That will be intensity, right? I don't see, yes, I do see something. That can't be good. What are we doing here? So we got some stuff going on here. What the heck is going on? This can't be good. Let me turn off the... Okay, so that was my input. It is my fault. Let me drive a lot less. I don't know what I'm doing here. There's a problem. Okay, I'll have to investigate. So I finally figured out how to do this. It's a combination about how much input I got, like that, and then this is the center point. But it goes really weird with the input like this. But then there is no horizontal gain. See, this is the problem. I'm not going to fill out the horizontal deflection, that is the problem. My input here is 1 kilohertz, and it is not really affected about the input frequency. Oopsie. So there's a very good low frequency response. Try and see that. Yeah. So I think we need to open this and see if we can get some more horizontal. I think that is definitely the problem of this unit. It is actually working. Obviously what we saw here, that was just the floating input of horizontal input. So that cable here is now connected to the rear BNC horizontal input. And now it is working. This is 100 millivolt RMS signal. That is all you need. And I put in 50 hertz in this channel and 50.2 hertz on the other channel. And this is, of course, how I generate this really nice and beautiful circle that is moving like this. And of course, you can, if I change my input instead of 50 hertz, go to 100. Oops, I go over here. 100 hertz. You're going to get two of them, just like that. So I really think this unit works. After all, it was just me using it wrong. I kind of didn't know that. It's also a little bit annoying. You have vertical input on the front and horizontal input on the back. Could have been a lot smarter to have both the BNCs here on the front. That's how I would have preferred it to be like that, right? So I think it's time to open this and have a look. Here's how I would adjust this for correct level and position and all that kind of stuff. Now I input 50 Hertz on both of the inputs, and I just took the phase adjustment on one of them and put it into 90 degrees. Of course, I should get a perfect circle, and this way I can adjust for level and position. So you see, I actually get a little bit of distortion here when I'm overdriving the input. But if I am down like that, it looks like a perfect circle to me. So I'm super happy about that. All that seems to be working. And now it's, yeah, really nice. So it's real easy to take away the four finger screws and then get in here and remove this green plastic so we can clean this up on both sides and get a real nice picture. And now it's easier to see the CRT, and it looks a lot like one of those tiny TV sets. I can actually see a tiny little burned phosphor dot here in the middle. So somebody was not careful when they power this up without input and give it a lot of brightness. Of course, you can damage the phosphor in the middle. So there's a tiny, tiny little dot here in the middle. I don't know if you can see this on the video, but and it's not really visible when you put on this green acrylic. Oh, I just found the problem. When you power this unit off by a remote switch, then it's gonna go into burn the damn dot in the middle. The way to turn this off correctly is to turn down here the intensity and then click. Ooh, did you see that? It still happens. Oh no, so there's a problem. If only I had the schematic. There's definitely a blanking problem. How the heck do you avoid this? And it goes into full brightness and then it destroys the screen. Okay, so we definitely cannot turn this on and off a lot of times in the middle, but there's another trick. What we could do is take the position like this to the side and then turn it on. Where are we? Here are we, right? So that means every time you turn this off, you need to do something like this. No, it goes there as well. Oh no. So this, the position is turned off first and then it's just smashing on the CRT. Oh, the beam like that. Oh no. Bad, bad. So now we are inside this absolutely beautiful product, and it is in a state I would call brand new. It really, really looks like it's new. And it was magnetic deflection, just like a normal TV set tube. So that's more or less what we got here. And mounting and everything is just absolutely perfect. So there's a board here doing a little bit of the different power supplies and deflections and stuff. I thought the two transistors or the two heat sinks on the back, that could have been power supply, but that is not what it is. If we have a little look here, that is magnetic deflection, goes here. And that is a vertical deflection, by the way. And look at that, those two transistors, they're connected to that connector. So that is vertical deflection transistors. That big and powerful stuff. And then we got some flyback diodes and a little resistor for a current and all that, a little bit of feedback transistors and stuff for that. So that was the vertical, right? So let's find the horizontal. We got some wires down here. We also got the two transistors down here. And we also got the same resistor, and we got the same flyback diodes. Let's have a look from the other side here. It's easiest to see. And that is, of course, the horizontal deflection. So, and that input here, that was the set axis, that is brightness. So what I think you could do is take and follow the signal here. So that will be brightness, that will be brightness, and it goes to some of that stuff, and it goes to some of that stuff. And I think it should be possible to figure out how to blank the display completely when this unit is powered on and powered off, put in some little time, and this way you're not going to destroy the CRT anymore with that big powerful dot in the middle here. That is definitely a design error. I don't have a, if I had the schematic, I would have done this mod in a few seconds, because it's probably extremely simple if you have the schematic. And that will be the high voltage stuff. It's probably all integrated into one little unit here. And it probably say something about, oh, you shouldn't touch this and you shouldn't do that, and it's very dangerous. 1673 is maybe the voltage, right? I would expect quite a lot of kilovolts for a tube like this. And it goes, of course, to the side. There's a big, big rectifier bridge down there, the big black one. And there's actually also some more stuff here at the bottom. I think we should take away the bottom lid here and have a look. So this is the bottom lid removed. So this is, of course, where all the pre-amplifiers are located. So that will be all the vertical stuff, and this is the horizontal stuff, and it's actually both horizontal and vertical on this same input board. You can see some temperature matched parts. That's of course so we don't have any drift. And we got a lot more input gain on the vertical input like that. Will be two field effect transistors and some normal silicon transistors like that. So it's quite modern, this product. I'm really sad that I don't have any schematics, manuals or anything like that, so I can't even tell you how old is this design, but it's probably between 1980, 1990, something like that. So it's of course not from yesterday or anything like that, but it is still quite modern and everything, and I didn't clean it up at all. And if you have a look here, it's just, I mean, you could more or less eat from this. It is really that clean. Super, super nice. Let's check this thing for a speed. This is 2 kilohertz on both vertical and horizontal. And let's play with the vertical. And dial it down to 1 kilohertz. Let's go to 500. Hertz. Okay, let's go on the horizontal 1 kilohertz. Okay, so that's better. So it's definitely not the 10 kilohertz that we're talking about, or I've seen it. I've been googling a little bit around with this thing here, and 10 kilohertz, well, so definitely horizontal shouldn't go fast. And this is vertical. Let's go up. That will be 1 kilohertz as well. Okay, so that is 10. So that is 10 kilohertz on vertical, and that seems to be all right, right? But it's a horizontal that is the problem. See, 2 kilohertz, and it goes absolutely unstable. 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah. So that is how it is. Horizontal should be slow. 1 kilohertz max on horizontal. And there's absolutely no problem in going higher than 10 kilohertz on vertical. Ooh, that was some. That is 13 kilohertz. That is not good. Okay, so that is 11 kilohertz and back to 10. So that is not a lie. All right. So I don't have a lot more stuff to say about this super, super cool and nice oscilloscope, other than please fix this blanking problem. Then you're not going to ruin the CRT.